Stanford University.
So, George, I want to talk to you a little bit about your being chair. But one last question about the department overall. You came in 1983, so you've been here over 30 years. So can you reflect on, has the department changed in that time from when you began to now you're emeritus? Any changes in the department?
It changed quite a bit, which is the right thing to do. Because you don't want to be today that you were 33 years ago. So the changes are good. When I came here, and this was one of the drawing for me, the departments were full of stars. Hmm. I mean, I think every full professor was a member of the academy. Hmm. And we had, I think, a department more National Academy of Engineering members than most universities, School of Engineering's had.
Wow.
I mean, there was a very star-studded faculty, and in their fields they were the giants, Holt, Ashley, and I don't want to list name, but all of them were that. And they all retired, they were all the same age pretty much, and retired together, so which was could be foreseen. And so then new ones came in. I came in, right? Although I wasn't that young, but Brian Cantwell and Ilan Crow. So after them, it was a rejuvenating process.
Yes.
And that was a very big difference. And then later on, even another group came in, and now we have, out of 12, four assistant professors. And there was a period in between we had none. So that is that. So it's turned over, and the full professors are still also very, very good. So the quality stayed up, but a lot of people came in who were not in at the time, and their interest changed. One very important change is in the department, that the department was very engineering, emphasizing engineering, like MIT, you know, projects. And it developed that now it's more balanced. We have that, but we also have a lot of numerical. The current chairman, Sharbel, getting all the medals in the world for his...
Yeah, Sharbel Farhad is quite well-known.
For his computational work, but the young people too. So that brought a balance because we have both sides to it, right?
Was that done by design, or was the best faculty member available hired at that time? How did that evolve?
I think it was not by design, but it was the best faculty member hired, and it was best because that was the going field.
Yes, yes.
Right?
And is the department in good shape today, would you say?
I think the department is in excellent shape because we have four new faculty members, young assistant professors,
yes.
I think it's four, and two females and hiring some more. So and they are excellent. They are superb, and they still have senior members, Per Enge, Ilan Crow,
yes,
Juan Alonso. Fuku Cheng.
Yes.
The order doesn't mean anything. And Sharbel, of course.
Yes, sir.
I mean, just as I pop in my mind.
Right.
And so it's really and still. You still always rank number one or two. And
so, as chair, when you came on and you served as chair from 1990 to 2001,
yes.
as chair, you inherited a department, as you described, that was been in transition coming in. What were the issues that you had to deal with when you came in as chair? Was there anything dramatic or difficult for you as a chair that you had to address?
I go back one step here.
Yes.
Just before Bob stepped down.
Bob Cannon.
We had lunch, and I said to him, where is the department going to go, because everybody's retiring.
Yes.
Because of big names, you know.
You're right.
And so I talked to him, I could see it coming. And so when I became a chair, I realized that we have to hire new faculty, but it was very difficult to get billets. Mm. All right, so it was very, very difficult. So, and there was nobody, they retired, but we didn't have enough room to hire.
And who was dean then? Was it Gibbons or Hennessy?
Gibbons.
Gibbons was dean.
Well, no. No, Gibbons, still
Jim
Gibbons.
Gibbons was
Jim Gibbons, yeah. I'm sorry, Hennessy
right.
came later.
Yeah.
So what I did was, and that was to hire a non-tenure line faculty, and that worked very well, and our department was only, in fact, there was a national study somewhere on the East Coast, somebody did about non-tenure line faculty, and we will use this as an example how to use this, because we hired people who had a very distinguished career in their jobs, and they sort of retired early. So they were on soft money, but they didn't worry because they had the retirement. They enjoyed it, they loved it, and they were top of the world.
Yes.
They were all famous. I mentioned a few names, Dick Christensen.
Yes, sir.
Steve Tsai.
Yes.
Dean Chapman.
Yeah.
They were all very
so they came in as faculty appointments, but soft appointments. They came in as
that's right.
As
research professors.
Right.
Research
right.
professors.
Right.
Per Anke.
Oh yes. Oh,
he came as a research yes. professor. Yes.
And was that a strategy that worked for the department?
It worked very well, because only Per was later became a regular faculty
right.
member.
Right.
All of them became later a member of the academy.
Yes.
And even today, they're still active in the department.
Is that still an approach the department uses?
Haven't done it lately. We
no.
haven't done it, but that worked. And interestingly enough, we hired a faculty member, Bob Twiggs.
Oh, I know Bob, sure. Small satellite guy.
Small satellite guy,
yeah.
Who developed a CubeSat
yes.
here, and everybody knows the word CubeSat. It became a word like aspirin, generic word for CubeSat. And because Bob wasn't a self-promoter, like some of us are, nobody knows it. It bothers me that nobody knows it's a Stanford thing.
Mm.
It's used all over the world, CubeSat, and they're using it and everything else. And we're still doing it, but it was born in the Duran building.
I remember working with Bob. He was a very popular teacher.
Very popular teacher.
Students were lined up. They wanted to
yes,
class.
Yes, yes.
Right.
And he started a program which is flying high now in our department. And in fact, we have two professors who are teaching it. They are not tenure line. They're doing it for fun.
Yes.
And so it's going very well. And we have young professors, two or three, who are doing it tenure line, assistant professors.
And you talked earlier about when you came on that the department was very collegial and very friendly. Is that still true over the years?
Yes, yes.
That's sometimes a rare in academic departments to do that. So a couple of other questions. During the period you were chair, there was lots of discussion going on, and I'm thinking of the time, particularly when John Hennessy was dean. I remember in the executive committee, the discussion about building bridges between disciplines and building bridges between academic departments. Were you involved in any of that part from the as chair or the AE department on doing that of cutting across disciplines and working with other departments?
Yes, I think practically every faculty member has a joint appointment or at least a courtesy appointment.
Yes.
An interesting thing was that Harish wanted me to have a joint appointment in
this Harish Shah.
Harish Shah,
right.
Sorry, in civil engineering,
mm.
but Cannon wouldn't allow it.
Really?
Really.
And what was the rationale for that?
I don't know. He didn't want me to do that. So I was his courtesy member, but I went to all the faculty meetings and everything else.
Yes.
And in our laboratory, where we had Professor Cheng, Fuku Cheng,
yes.
came, We have about 20 students all the time between the two of us. Nobody would know from the other which department they were in. And we had students from material science, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, computer science. We had all kinds of students,
right.
Civil engineering,
right.
And nobody knew where they were from.
Right. And you saw that evolve over the years. What's your take on that approach of, rather than thinking about universities typically as silos where each department and even individual disciplines within a department are very isolated, and now it's opening up. Any thoughts about that approach?
Yes, I have two thoughts on it, because I thought about it quite a bit, and this is my individual thought. One is that it's very, very good when all the cooperation is encouraged and facilitated and helped, but it cannot be forced.
Yes.
Because, you know, I taught 50 years on the nose full time, and after the 50 years I'm still coming in every day to the office, yes, and see what's going on, and I'm involved. I've seen terrific cooperations and zero. You cannot force professors to cooperate.
How do you get them to cooperate?
You make it possible and then hope it works. A little bit like marriage, maybe, I don't know whether it's a good analogy or not. But you cannot make it if it doesn't work. I had in postdocs coming out, you know, I had lots of postdocs. And a few of them, we worked beautifully, still work together, wrote books together and everything else. And some of them came the first day, were a year here, came back last day to say goodbye. And everybody, so you can't force it.
See, I remember hearing Jim Plummer, and I think John Anderson said the same thing about getting faculty members to work together is like herding cats. And how do you get them to work together? You move the food, and the food, it would be resources, facilities, and so forth. They would attract faculty members to come together. In the absence of that, it's very difficult.
That's what I said, that you facilitate it.
Right.
So I'm saying exactly what they said. I'm not contradicting them.
Yeah.
If you don't do that, then it's hopeless.
Right.
Yeah. First of all, they have to put them close proximity. You cannot have even the different floors. People don't,
yes,
communicate, busy.
Yes.
And facilitate, make everything possible, but it doesn't guarantee it. You
right.
cannot tell two professors you two work together.
Right. Like you can't force them to do that.
No, cannot do that.
There needs to be an incentive, a motivation, an inducement, reward, something to get them to work together,
yes,
in some way.
To help them develop the context, but
right.
beyond that, you can't do anything.
Right. So, as you were chair, you obviously lasted a long time, as 11 years. What do you think the qualities are to be a successful chair at Stanford? What kind of person needs to be there as a successful chair?
I think the most important thing is, well, let me tell you that. Two things I wanted to say. One is that, as I mentioned earlier, I never wanted to be a chair. So when it came up, I was so surprised. And one reason I accepted it, because I didn't think I can do it. So I was curious if I can do it.
Oh, as a challenge.
As a challenge.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
It's like being an astronaut.
Yeah, right.
And one day I went to see Jim Plummer, who was the dean. And I said, what can I do for you, George? I said, look out the window. I said, well, I said, look at how beautiful it is. He said, what are you talking about, you crazy Hungarian? I said, look at the beautiful weather. I'd rather be playing golf than be chair. I'm stepping down. So I stepped down.
Yeah.
I said, 11 years, you need fresh blood.
Yes. Right.
You have to revitalize. You have to,
right.
You don't be first alive.
That's right.
But I think, and there are, every faculty member is different. So the first thing is, I think that you have to know hire. You have to have very good people. Hiring is very, very important. And the best I have seen hiring is Bob Cannon, Professor Cannon, Bob Cannon.
Why do you say that? What
because
is it that
he could see talent. He is a terrific hire. He did very, very well. I mean, a large portion of faculty he attracted, he was very good.
Hmm.
And the second thing is, once you hire that, the best people and all that, you have to make sure, and I always tell them, the chairman's job is to make sure that they have what they want or need. make sure that the work environment
yes.
is. That involves helping them to do what they want.
Yes.
Do the best you can to be able for them to work.
Yes.
And make sure that the atmosphere is friendly, so whether there are some controversies or something, that you try honestly to take care of it.
It's interesting to say that my approach at Stanford, and I think I've seen chairs do this as well, is the approach is you think about the structure of a department. The chair is not at the head. If it's like a triangle, he's at the bottom, and his job is to help everybody else be successful.
Excellent.
And I think that's consistent around
that's
Stanford,
exactly.
right?
Yes, yes.
The people who think they're the boss and in charge here at Stanford won't succeed.
No.
And this idea of when I was director and as your job as chair is to get everybody we work with to be successful. And I think you hit
it exactly. That's what I was trying to say.
Right, I think you hit it exactly right. There was something I read about you that I thought was quite amusing. You at one point gave a speech at Sydney, the University of Sydney, and you talked about in the speech you had a radical approach to commencement speeches in your department. Something funny happened with that. Can you want to say what that was?
Oh yes, we used to have the customary. So each Stanford and many universities, everybody goes to the big ceremony in the football stadium, and then the departments go back to their own.
Yes.
And give out the degrees
right.
individually,
right.
just for those who wouldn't know, happen to know that. And the usual thing, people speak. And Nicholas Hoff started it, no speeches in any function.
Oh!
None whatsoever. So, and I carried that on, no speeches, no matter what, no speeches. So we didn't have any speeches. But then the faculty sits up on the platform, and what I did was I got a photograph of every faculty member as a baby. As a kid, you know, baby, or I'm in a crib myself, and I introduced them, and I flashed the photo of them, and that was
much more entertaining and probably relevant
yes,
than
yes.
listening to these long-winded speeches.
And now, Charbel did a step further. It was very good after so many years. He still has it, but. He says a few words about what the faculty is doing.
Yes.
So and has a regular picture. But it's still carried on, and so that's what I did. And there were no speeches. It was in the summer heat. It was went very fast.
I like that. That's
the baby pictures.
I'm sure it was very entertaining for the people in the audience. So one of the things as chair, you had an opportunity to work with three different deans: Jim Gibbons, John Hennessy, and Jim Plummer.
Yes.
Each of them different in their own way. Anything in reflection about working with them that you want to talk about and working with any of those deans?
I had good relationship with all three of them. They're very different. They're excellent. And a good dean has to have two attributes. They have to know what to do, what is right to do. That's the second, as it is, have to know what's the right thing to do, what to do about it, and the guts to do it.
Ah.
The first two, most of them have.
Right.
The third one is difficult.
It's always hard.
The third one is very hard. And they had it all. I mean, they were all in their own way, very differently, but they were
yes.
all very smart. Jim Gibbons and Hennessy made decisions faster, not super fast, but faster. Plummer was very deep thinking, and he thought about it,
right.
but he came up with a good answer too.
Right. I think in reflection, having worked with all
yes.
three, when you look back at this era of those deans during that period of time, 100 years from now, this will be a particularly powerful group in a very positive way to get things done. Right?
Yes.
When you think about the way the school has evolved, the new facilities, and every department is involved, the faculty hires, ratcheted Stanford up even further in its stature around the country. So I agree with you. We were both fortunate to work with three very good guys. Yes. I was very pleased with that. So in reflection of being department chair for the 11 years, would you have done anything differently?
No. Maybe I would think very hard, but no.
Yeah, that's good.
I did okay.
Let me do a bit of a shift on your history of being a faculty member during some interesting times. From
can I just go back to chairmanship?
Yes, of course. Yeah.
I think one thing what I did, and I don't know, I was always very open, totally transparent.
Yeah.
And for instance, when faculty brought money in, some chairman, you know, industrial affiliates or whatever, kept it. I always give most of it or whatever, or as much as to back to them.
Yes.
Because they had the money, so why take it away?
Right.
And I made decisions. I told them what we are doing and why. So there was not really controversy. That one controversy was when we had a library, and I want to mention this is we had a library on the top of on the top floor. Remember
on the Duran building,
fourth floor, and nobody could use it. There was no library, and everything was hung all over the place. It's a mess.
Yeah, it was. I remember.
And earthquake came and it fell down. Everything was on the floor.
Yes.
And we had a terrific building manager named Vadim.
Vadim, yes, I know him. Yes.
And he came to me, what shall we do? I said, throw it out. Especially because we needed a space for students, which turned into a terrific space.
Yes.
And threw it out. So comes back a few days later and says, we can't do that because Professor X said that a very valuable repose there that he needs to, we need that, we can't throw it out. But I knew that he can get it from Berkeley or NASA, so there was available. I said, that's okay. As much as you can, put them in boxes and put his office. So 3 days later, the Professor X comes and says, what's going on? I said, well, I understand you need these documents and we didn't want to throw it out. Throw it out.
Now, see, that's the mark of a good leader, a creative solution. I like that. That was fantastic. I want to go back to the era in which you lived as a faculty member through Sputnik, Apollo years, and aerospace. And that's when aerospace was a computer science of the time. Now there's a renaissance of aerospace led by many IT industries. Do you see any parallels from your life on back then as to what's going on today? Any lessons to be learned from aerospace in the past to what's happening today?
Well, yes and no. But let me just give you a few examples, all right?
Go ahead.
I started with the computer science. I happen to know that it was in the 50s, or what, I'm not sure we can find the date out. There are some people who came that we need a, Stanford needs a computer science department. And the physics and math department got up in revolt.
Oh.
We don't need it because that's not science. That's like trade. And there's a big hullabaloo, and there was a very high-level committee made. Terman had a committee. It was a very contentious issue at the time. It was the 50s or late, something like that,
yeah.
Maybe early 60s. And then Terman said, yes, we'll have one. And look where it is now. So it's very hard, but it was a big, big deal. Looking back, you would laugh.
Right.
That Stanford was upset about having a computer science. And we don't have, it's not a trade school. So, and you see where it's now. The same thing, Hennessy would say, well, look at the civil engineering. And one of the most famous saying, and everybody quotes it now, was they would try to hire somebody in civil engineering. I think you may have been there, I was there, when I think Jim Plummer was chairman of the department. And this person was hired because his expertise is in concrete. And a famous statement was, what's new in concrete? Do you remember that?
I do remember that. And you I do. Know the faculty member you're talking about, yes.
Well, that's irrelevant. It wasn't. Turns out that
it's a lot.
It was a lot, and it developed, and it had a renaissance.
Yes, right.
But I told you I changed, and this is an important message. And looking back, I changed almost every 10 years. You know, MIT. I told you, here, total field change of field MIT, yes. Total field of change of Michigan, total change. Every field is 10 or 15 years. And then it runs its course. It's not end. It matures.
Yes.
Oh. And a new field comes in.
Right.
And I give examples. I mean, from the transistor, not the, you know, the little wire radio, the crystal radios.
Yes, of course. Yes.
And then came the, in electrical engineering used to be electric motors and transformers.
Right.
Then tubes.
Right.
Then transistors, not
right.
chips. So it evolves. And the same thing, and Hennes always says, so what's new in aeronautics? I mean, and I had a lunch once, when I was chairman, with the chairman of Boeing, and says, what do you want? We can fly from one point to the halfway around the Earth. We can't go any further. What do you want? And look what happened now.
Right.
He never mentioned the fact that you're going to get your dinner delivered to your table with a little bug into the window.
Right.
You never know what's coming.
Right. You don't know what's coming. It strikes me, and I'd be curious about your take on as things evolve in the space program, which is becoming highly privatized.
Yes.
Any implications you think for the future for the department and the graduates of these programs? Any issues around that surface in your mind?
I'm not very good in foreseeing the future. But the answer is yes. We have our colleagues are already working on it, because making it smaller,
yes.
and cheaper, and travel in swarms. They use the word
yes,
swarms,
right. yes,
which are very difficult.
Right.
You know, in big spaces and very have to be very precisely done to do the kind of measure to use this for measurements. Satellites moving. Together, many satellites.
Right.
They have to be very, very carefully moved so that they don't separate too much. And so these are all new things that have not been.
And these are things that the department is, oh,
yes,
is
the
working
the
on.
The department is very heavily working in these things, yes.
One of the questions that came up, and this is your colleague Jeff Kosef, because you have this Sunday morning golf group with Charles Prober and John Hennessy and yourself. Jeff wanted to know how your golf game evolved. We can talk about that off camera if you want. But he also said to make sure to ask you about some interesting work as a scientist on your work with Golf Digest advisory panel. You want to talk a little bit about that and what that is?
Yes. Golf Digest started in fact 10 years ago, decided, you know, to something new, they evaluate the new equipment, because each year new equipment come out, like cars.
Yes.
And they didn't have any, they're just the writers of the magazine. And they got a tremendous flack from the industry. How can you write on the technology of the golf equipment?
Right.
So they decided to have a scientific panel, and I was from the first day on. In the meantime, it changed, but there are about six of us, seven of us. The other guys are terrific. They're all Caltech, MIT professors. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting. We don't get paid. We don't get equipment, nothing. So we are not, we have no conflict of interest.
Yes, right.
So it's, and we get together at a place, various places, Las Vegas, some golf resort, where there's amenities for conferences as a golf course. And before we go, we get all the specs from the companies. They give it to us because they want to look good for all the clubs. And we look through those specs, and then we meet and we discuss. We are looking at engineering.
Right.
So they say, this is something new, and we say, what's first of all, what's new about it, or what good is it?
Yes.
Yeah, it's new, but it's not good.
Yes.
Right? So you painted the shaft yellow, it's better. That's a real thing. but we spent, just now we spent, I was there recently for the next year once, and one of the companies have some kind of ribs inside the driver. And we spent an enormous amount of time telephoning them back and forth. Now, what is it for and what? And oh, we don't understand the purpose. And then we give it a feedback to the writers and they write it for legal reasons.
Right.
I mean, we don't speak with anybody. But, I mean, they take it and they publish it. But that's it's very interesting. These guys are very knowledgeable and you learned a lot about.
So all this work that you've done, which is interesting because it, you know, on composites, it's now informing an entire industry over time and your assessment with that. I hope it's improved your golf game.
Oh, it didn't.
didn't. Jeff Kolfsa said to make sure to ask you about that. I want to remember, I knew you've been on this committee. We talked a number of years ago. I said to you, so with the thousands of clubs that you've had a chance to assess, what would you recommend for me for clubs? Yeah, I remember forgotten something. He said, go get fitted. Is that the best thing?
So I have a, now that you brought it up, I always give something more to talk about.
Yes.
When Hennessy stepped out as president, the Pac-12 gave him a present of a new set of golf clubs from Nike.
Really?
They didn't realize that Nike is going out of business.
That's right. That's right. And maybe they're sending John a message like, you're going out of business.
And a fitting.
Oh, yes, right, a club
so,
fitting.
So
right.
Club fitting. But the Nike facility, called the Oven, for whatever reason, the Oven,
yes,
is in Houston.
Really?
So John said, come with me.
Oh,
so this was a
this.
Couple of months ago.
Oh.
We went there, the two of us, just flew out in the morning.
It was
he was fitted and we came back.
Yes.
And that's where they do the clubs for Rory and Tiger.
Yes,
I've had them there.
Wow.
And it's another that's another story what they do.
Yeah.
Has nothing. It's like a Formula One car compared to your Prius. So.
Right.
But anyway, as we go there, I wanted to make sure that everything is on the level. I said, just want to tell you that I'm on a hot list panel.
Yes.
No, and I had to get permission from Golf Digest. Had to out.
Oh, because
conflict
right.
of interest.
Yes.
So I did. I said out. He said, I hope you write good things about our clubs. And you see why I picked it up. I said, I don't see anything except I tell everybody that just go get fitted. And I said,
that's
right. And I said, not only that, when you're fitted, you have to buy the club that you're fitted with, not the other one.
Yes.
Because of it. And the guy grabbed my hand and says, you're the first one who said it. You're
really?
Right. He said, you're absolutely right.
That's right, because you get gauged on the fitting with one club, and then if you say, oh, no, well, rather than Titleist now, I'm going to go buy pink.
No, you can get the same Titleist, exactly the same club.
Yes.
From here, in other words, Titleist, this model, this. But this club is different because it's not so. Just a, it can be a degree different, and that's a lot.
Well, I want to thank you for the advice. The next set of clubs, I'm going to go get fitted.
Yeah, so go to the PGA.
The shop. PGA store here.
Yes.
Is that the better?
That's what I heard.
Okay. So when you think about challenges or crises that you've had at Stanford, anything of that jumps out at you and how you handle it, anything that caused you. Angst or difficulty about when you were chair as a faculty member at Stanford, anything of a difficult time and the way you handled it?
I didn't have much. I told you one.
Yes.
I had a retired professors keep their offices. I still have my offices as long as possible. I know how difficult it is. That's one thing I learned. Every September I go to Charbel Farhat, who is a chairman. And I said, well, anytime you want the office, just tell me and I'm out of it, so don't worry about it.
Yes.
But we had some young faculty member for whom this retired professor's office was very important because it was a cluster and he could have been, otherwise he would have been a different area of the building. And I asked this faculty member to move. I give another office, but not there where he was sitting for 25 years somewhere else. He just wouldn't move and he wouldn't move and wouldn't move. It was very, finally I said, that's enough, you go. And But the interesting thing is, so he did. And 2 years later, he wrote me a long handwritten letter apologizing.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's very good.
That he thought about it, and I was right.
Interesting. So let me extend this a little bit out. So we've been talking about within the school and the department. Anything that you've worked on for you that's been particularly interesting or challenged at a university level? Have you been involved at committees or anything that that you want to talk about?
Well, I can tell you a few things.
Please do.
There was a graduate committee once, which I owned almost 30 years ago.
Yes.
And
university-wide.
University-wide, and I got on it, and they was totally used a lot of money and was totally useless. And one day the dean came in to the committee and says, "They want us to give up this. How can we do that?" I said, "You know, which one can we give up?" No, I said, "Which one can we give up?" I said, "All of them."
Really?
Yes. So that there was, and then they stopped. They abolished the job. I mean, the graduate thing. When really, now that there is one, but it's a much different.
Yes.
You know, things.
Do you recall what that was?
There were several issues that had to do with the postdoc. They were handling all the postdocs and the visitors, and you know, they were in charge of every postdoc, every visitor, and everything else, and a lot of this, that, and other.
I have to reflect on my working with you. I've always been most appreciative of your frankness. You don't hold back.
No, well, that's good and bad.
Sometimes that's regarded as being impolitic, but on the whole, it's, I think, very healthy.
So you interviewed Channing.
Yes.
And we were chairs together, and we used to come out to the meeting, and Channing says, "George, I'm so glad you said it." And I said, "You son of a bitch, you're glad or you didn't have to say it."
Yeah, you never. I remember sitting in those executive committee meetings, you never held back. And that, I think, healthy.
But the committee, the executive committee, which of course is the chairs and the dean, which makes, it's the dean says it's advisory, but it's a strong advice.
Right, it is strong advice.
It's not executive, but it's strong advice. Right. I thought that was a useful committee and useful input.
So when you think about, again, whether it's university-wide or departmental or within the school, if you reflect on your career at Stanford, what did you enjoy the most and what did you enjoy the least?
The most I can tell you are the students and the colleagues. Coming from Michigan, which was a terrific place, but it's a very large place. The quality of the faculty in every sense of the word is terrific. Technically and professionally, I mean professionally, and by socially I mean you can talk to them about not just equations.
Yes.
And when we, Michigan, you couldn't go out and meet to a meeting where they don't start talking politics in a very, university politics in a very negative sense.
Oh, interesting.
Here it never is. I never forget the first one. I was, shortly after I came, was the Kennedy overhead issues.
Yes, the conflict.
Conflict.
The controversy around that, yes.
Controversy.
Yeah, around the overhead. Yeah.
And I can tell you about that too. Yeah. And I was coming from Michigan, I brought it up with one of my colleagues. I was been here for a long time, and he said, "That's not it. That's not something to discuss." And I realized that's not wasn't topic. Mind your own business. So that was very, because it was petty.
Yes. Yes.
Petty,
yes,
at Michigan.
Yes. It's also, I think, I've worked both at a public and a private university. There's something about public schools where the much greater bureaucracy and a focus around the politics than maybe in a, that's my take. I don't know if it's the same as yours.
What I enjoy very much, your colleagues, good students, right? Your colleagues, and you can mind your own business.
Oh.
All right?
Right.
And it's not politics of upstairs and,
right,
you know, what this does and that does.
That's very good. Is this, what did you, What did you not like about
what
was it that you least liked to get involved in or do?
Well, I tell you what I'd love, I'll tell you a couple of things that I don't like. There is such a thing as an emeriti council. Have you heard of it?
Yes, I know.
I'm a member on it.
Yes.
And they needed someone to serve on the Senate as a representative, yeah. And I was there for the last couple of years. And I think the Senate, I was on the Michigan Senate too, but I find it totally useless. I understand the need for it, but I find it totally useless. I mean, it's people can, it's like Hyde Park, you know, people can
get up and say what they need.
But so I didn't have to be a volunteer there because somebody had to do it. What I don't like about Stanford is, and it really could be, is this is a McDonald's franchise. There's Mr. Kroc on the top, you know, the Kroc, you know Kroc who started it. Stanford is Mr. Kroc. And you can pay and you can have a franchise, but don't expect anything from us. You pay for us. So you probably know, but I know, that as a chairman of the department, the School of Engineering, for my operating, we got 25% from the university. 75% we had to raise ourselves.
Yes.
And that is well, that's the way it is. It is what it is, as they say.
Yes.
I don't like it, I didn't. Which brings me to a new topic, if you have time.
Yes, of course.
What do I do now? And that feeds in. I come in every day. I tell them, and I give unwanted advice, which is not true. I don't give any advice. I stay away, and I only if they ask.
Okay.
But I take on jobs that are very time-consuming, very important, must be done, but it doesn't bring you credit or anything.
Yes.
I volunteer, so I run the admissions for the graduate department.
Oh.
So it's 500 or so applicants I read myself, and then we have endless meeting which I chair and select. So it's a lot of time.
Yes.
But you don't want young people to do that.
Right.
Christmas vacation reading thing. And this brings me where I picked it up, you know, the university. There was some pressure in the university or whatever. I don't know exactly where it came, but there's the pressure to start an undergraduate program. Have you heard that?
Yes, I have.
And so I volunteered to chair the program committee that will develop it. I started a year ago, more than a year ago now. I thought it would be a week and we can do it. Well, that was one of my biggest mistakes. We're still struggling with it. But we have it a beautiful program. Well, time will tell. But I'm happy to say that we did the best we could and we're happy with it. And if it's not good, it's not our, I mean, it's we didn't foresee it or whatever, but it's a great program. We have a problem because the university does not, as far as I know so far, doesn't want to give us any help, with what I hear back. I may be misunderstood because it's on record. I may hear it wrong, but the university says, no, you want a program, you raise the funds to equip the lab, you pay for the renovation of the rooms.
Yes.
I mean, come on, you have a program for the university, and you're supposed to build a building for the university to have a program that they wanted you to do.
So is that an issue that you think your colleagues around the campus feel the same? The central administration is there not to be as helpful as possible?
I can't tell you.
Yeah.
I can't speak for others. But that is a very big surprise to me. Mm-hmm. That I don't mind if they say that, look, I always had trouble with let me tell you what I have. This is good.
Yes.
But I had a big trouble with human resources.
Yes.
And now that you mentioned it came back, I had, when I was chairman, after 3 or 4 secretaries, assistants, they were absolutely hopeless. I mean, one of them said, I said, could you call up this person? I said, where do I find a number? I said, try the telephone book. And one couldn't type, and I mean, terrible. One after the other, and then I documented it. Funny, you know, so I did everything right. And then I get a letter, I was a chairman, from somebody in human resources, saying that you can't do that. If you do this again, you know, if you can't get along with your secretary, you won't be allowed to have a secretary.
Really?
Really. So I took my assistant, the department manager.
Yes.
I took this letter. I asked a meeting with the human resources people. I went in there. I said, you send this letter? Yes. I said, here is the letter. I don't expect it. I don't accept it. I leave. I turned it on and left. You can't leave it. I said, just watch it. And I moved out. Then Ann Hannigan.
Oh, yeah, no. Yes. Senior Associate Dean for Administration, yes, in the Engineering School.
Called me at lunch. I knew her very well.
Yeah.
I said, George, I can't do that because what happens is if there's a lawsuit or whatever, jury goes, you look very bad it's documented. I mean, they're hopeless. Mm. So all they were there, and when the secretary left, they always interviewed them.
Yes, that's
but
that's
they
right.
Never interviewed me. So all they were there to protect the university. They were not there to.
So that's interesting. I mean, you're talking about the pluses and minuses. That certainly is a minus.
Oh, it's a very bad minus.
That's a very interesting. That's a.
You never had such a thing.
Of course I have. When I directed my center, I had the same issues coming up. Document for people, and then realize, wait a minute, it wasn't quite right. It was.
Ended they up don't help
some,
you.
Some contentious cases. It was not. If you ask me, on retirement, what is it that I miss and don't miss? I say, what don't I miss? HR.
That's
exactly number right. One. I'm glad enough to deal with that. So,
and by the way, just to finish it off,
go ahead.
I don't know how it is now because I haven't done it for 10 or some years, but the help that we got from the business office, where applications went through the grant research administration, was atrocious. The help that we got, we had to do everything, and if you ask them to have it, this has to be in by tomorrow morning or day after tomorrow, we can't do that. We have to go home now. There's no help.
That's the problem when you have to rely on another department to help you get something done. That can be hard. So, yeah. We're coming to a conclusion here on some of this. I have a few more questions. That this was one that I think this was a Jeff Kosef question. He said, how has Stanford changed since you have been here? Are we better off now or worse? Is life as a faculty member more pleasant or tougher, do you think, during the time you were here?
Stanford and engineering grew tremendously. I mean, look at the engineering quad. So what I have seen, most facilities are much better.
Yes.
Now, if you don't have a facility, but we were, my lab was, in Ginston or whatever. You remember those?
Of course I do. The old blockhouse type buildings. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, there were some horrible labs and horrible spaces. So the infrastructure and that really, really got better. I mean, Durand, where you and I were.
Yes.
Was remodeled.
Yes.
And build new buildings all over the place. Speaking from a school of engineering, furthermore, other facilities. For instance, the Wing Center.
Yes.
I mean, I'm talking in general.
Yes.
The art.
Performing Arts Center.
The whole art center, the Wing and the music and all that. Sports have facilities.
Yes.
So it really went into the 21st century. The facilities went to the 21st century.
Right. Quite extraordinary the way it was under John Hennessy's administration that's changed dramatically.
Yeah, but I'm just talking for the faculty. Now, again, looking at the new buildings doesn't affect me, but for the junior faculty, there's housing along.
Yes. Right.
So it's you might say that it's difficult because of the Palo Alto prices, but if I look at the universities did much, I mean, there was no Escondido Village.
That's true. That's true. So going a bit further with this, so if you could now reflect on your experience here, what advice would you give to a new faculty member coming to Stanford on how to be successful here?
Do a good teaching. Mind your own business. That's Stanford.
Yes.
Because some people think that if I will be very active at the university, that will get me, you know, it'll be world famous at Stanford. World famous in Palo Alto. That's a Hungarian expression translated. You want to be world famous, but not world famous in Palo Alto. So you know here and there, but you want to, so do, here's what I would say. Do a good teacher job in teaching, but that's your job, right? You can do it. Select a good mentor and get into a research field that is developing.
Did you have a good mentor?
I had a good mentor at MIT.
Did you have somebody help you here that you could point to that you could?
Yes.
Who was that?
Nicholas Hoff.
Oh, yeah.
Now, by that time, I didn't need a research mentor. I needed chairman mentors.
Yes.
And he was. Anytime I had some problem, I went to him because everybody has problems. You know, little,
right,
I don't remember.
You just need somebody to talk to and get some advice.
Need somebody advice and talk to. And I, that referred to the commencement speech I gave at Sydney.
Yes.
I said, I started out saying that you need three things in life. You have to work hard, because if you don't work hard, there's nothing you can do. You need luck, timing. Remember, if I don't go in Tokyo down the basement, the banquet, I don't.
Right.
And you need help.
Yeah.
And you look back, I'm sure you had help.
Yes.
Everybody has to
have
help.
Everyone has help. Right.
But if you don't work hard, they cannot help you.
Right. Right. I've always been, you know, the saying that luck is the residue of hard work. I mean, the harder you work, the luckier you get, right?
Yes.
That's the saying, and what you've pointed out is exactly right. Exactly. So as we reach a conclusion here, is if you could think back about your career, if you were advancing it today, you were a young George Springer coming, would you go in a different direction? Would you do anything differently?
No.
That's good. That means that's good. Tell me a little bit about your personal and family life. I know you met your wife when you were at MIT, and there's something about her father that had some connection to Stanford.
Well, her father was at Stanford.
Your wife's name is Susan?
Susan,
yes.
Flory, F-L-O-R-Y.
Yes.
And his father was in the chemistry department.
Here at Stanford?
Here at Stanford. He was a Nobel Prize winner, which he got at Stanford, but before we got here.
Yes.
I must say that nobody knew the connection when I was hired, so and I wanted to keep it that way. So.
And you live on campus?
We live on campus,
and
yes.
What's that experience been like, living on campus?
Fantastic. Terrific. I really like it. The people on the street where we live, San Francisco Court, are very nice, very friendly, but not overly. In other words, you live your own life. It's not that they don't poke their nose in what you do, but at Christmas there is a party,
yes,
and they get together. And used to be 4th of July picnic on the street, but we didn't have it lately.
Right.
But very, very friendly, very supportive.
And what was it like for your two daughters growing up here?
They didn't grow up here.
They didn't.
Because the older one was already in college, mm-hmm, in the East Coast, and the other one was here just, we came when she was, I think, entered junior year in high school.
Mm.
So it was a very short time only. So they didn't really grow up here.
So you retired in 2009, you were emeritus. And you told me a little bit of how you're spending your time within the department, helping with admissions. How else have you been spending your time professionally and personally?
Professionally, after that, I still had some students that to finish up the PhDs, all that. As I said, I come in every day and talk to, you know, try to find admissions takes time, and not this whole year took up. Took my year with this developing an undergraduate curriculum,
yes.
meeting up a meeting
yes.
up a meeting. So that's mostly my professional. Privately, as I said, I like to play golf. I read a lot and do some travel. My wife Susan loves to travel more than I like, but
so. It's good to have wives who push you in areas maybe you don't want to be.
Yes.
I have one
yes.
like that as well. So are there any questions you wish I had asked, or anything you want to add to our conversation as we wrap up here?
No, I can tell you that I was very, very fortunate to end up at Stanford. And I honestly tell you, I lived in Hungary, I lived in Australia, I lived in Boston, Michigan here. This is the best place in the world, and I mean it.
I agree with you.
I just want to tell you, I had a tough youth, not because I had family was as good as can be in Hungary, but because of the war and communism. Communism was very, very hard on me.
Right.
And so I'm very fortunate that I came out of it and I'm here.
And so last question is, when you think about as you finish your career here, and in reflection, what are you most proud of, and what do you hope your legacy will be?
Well, I mean, first, let me tell you that my most proud of and the legacy will be the children, grandchildren, right? I mean, that's obvious,
right?
And the second one is all those students whom I taught. Research, not just the PhD students, but I figure in 50 years of teaching, because you know I came back and taught active duty more after
yes,
I retired.
Yes, right.
I mean, I think it's upwards of 10,000. Mm. I mean, you know, 30 years, figure it out. I mean, because at Michigan, big classes.
Right.
So I mean, 8,000. I don't know, but. It's a lot of students.
It's interesting, as I've done these interviews, what I hear repeatedly from faculty members at the end is that the legacy is that the impact they've had on other people's lives.
That's right.
And
yes,
that's, I mean, yes, that comes up
yes.
repeatedly because you've
influenced. What else is there?
That's exactly right. You know, you want to leave a piece of you behind, and the way you do that is with the people you work with and the students that you've had. Anything else we've not covered that you'd like to talk about?
No, I think this.
This has been good, George. I've really enjoyed
it. I enjoyed
this.
It. I had no idea what to expect. I never gave one.
This worked out well. So I think we'll ask them. We're finished with our interview now. And thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, George.
Thanks a lot.
It was always fun. I always enjoy talking
yes.
to you.